Imagine a world where robots are part of your everyday life, and not only as helpers, but also as companions and friends. And where the minds of such robots are not just built in the big technological centers of the world, like Silicon Valley, but they're built even in a small oasis city in the middle of the Arabian desert, such as Alain. Furthermore, imagine a world in which we can all participate in wider intelligent entities that are made up of potentially thousands of humans and machines, even with 10 seconds of our time every day, and whose capabilities might far surpass the current limits of both human as well as artificial intelligence. And finally, imagine a world where we can harness the collective mind and intellect of the citizens of our nations in order to be able to bring forth effective participatory governance for the smart green cities of the future. These three have been my dreams and goals in the last 10 years, and they have partially produced some fruit, such as Ebon Cena, the world's first Arabic-speaking android robot, in the words of the BBC, as recorded in my lab.
Discoveries. But unlike his older counterpart, this Ebon Cena is altogether more high-tech. As well as being fluent in English and Arabic, he can hold a conversation with humans. He looks for information about us on the internet and uses that to chat with us. He'll also remember it for the next time you meet. But this lab isn't in Japan, China, or the United States. It's in Alain, just an hour's drive from the UAE capital, Abu Dhabi.
I would like to ask you to embark with me upon a journey that will have three parts. First, I will start with a very short history of intelligence on the planet Earth to arrive to the moment where we actually have robots interacting with humans. Then, I will talk about individual intelligence and how this scales up to collective intelligence. And in the end, I will go to a most crucial question, I think, for today. How can we harness the collective mind of our citizens in order to bring forth effective participatory governance? Let us start. In the beginning, the Earth was full of lifeless matter. And then, the first organisms appeared. And later, the first animals that could actually perceive the world through their sensors, their eyes, and their ears, and then mediated through their natural intelligence, they could act upon the world through their muscles. Later, humans appeared, and with them, the first man-made objects, such as tools. And much later, a very special kind of man-made object, machines, that could run along on their own. And it wasn't until very recently that we started getting the first intelligent machines, such as computers. But ask yourselves, how much has our life changed since the introduction of intelligent machines? Just think, in the last week, how much time have you spent in direct interaction, one-to-one, with another person? Versus how much time have you spent in electronic-mediated interaction, through your cell phone or through a messaging system? Versus, more importantly, how much time have you spent interacting with a machine, another human, with a website, with a computer game, with an ATM, and in the future, with robots? The average American is spending 2 hours of his day online, and a very big part of this time has to do with interaction with machines, not with humans. So we're spending more and more time with them, and slowly. And then came robots. And robots are very different than other intelligent machines. They don't need to have somebody sitting at the keyboard in order to feed them with information from the world, as you need for a computer. They have their own sensors. They can perceive the world through their cameras and their vision systems, through their sonars, through their auditory sensors, and so on. And most importantly, they can also directly act upon the world. They have their own muscles, which are their motors in this case. And the connection between the sensors and the motors happens through their artificial intelligence. For example, when it comes to chess, the Deep Blue computer of IBM was able to win over Kasparov, the world champion of chess. But still, In many, many other things, human intelligence is far superior to machine intelligence. Take, for example, the motor abilities of a 5-year-old girl. If you get the best biped humanoid robot, like Asimo that you saw, it is much worse when it comes to what it can do. Take also the abilities of young children to be able to continuously learn in an exploratory manner. Again, the best machine learning program out there cannot even think about doing something like that. There are insurmountable limits, though, to what a single intelligent entity, either it being human or being machine, can do on its own. And this is why participating in groups is not only very, very pleasant as an activity, but it can enable us to do things that we cannot even think of alone. But the intermediate stage between the single individual and the group is the pair. In this case, a pair of a robot and a human interacting with one another. And most of the work that I have done so far in my lab actually has to do with exactly this setting. And let me share with you three interesting examples of that. First, the robot Replay, which has the form of a helping hand. You can give it commands in language, it helps you with things that you want to do on a table, and it can learn the meaning of words through examples. Let us see it in action.
Where is the red one?
At the top.
Look at the center.
Okay.
Where is the red one?
So up there you can see what the camera sees.
At the top.
And this is a model of the world that it makes.
What color are the objects?
One is red and the other is green.
It cannot see the red object anymore, but it still remembers
it.
Imagine
a blue object on the left.
Now we're telling it that there is an object on the left where it cannot see, so it's imagining an object and it waits to see it when it looks at the left.
Where is the blue one?
Most probably at the left.
How big is the blue one?
I have no idea.
Look at the left.
And now he will see what he was imagining before and verify that indeed what I was telling him is true, that there is a blue object.
Okay.
And it will know how big it is.
How big is the blue one?
Small.
And the robot can also remember.
How big was the blue one when your head started moving?
I have no idea.
Where was the red one when the green one appeared?
Most probably at the top, but maybe not.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So you see how slowly these machines are learning how to bring part of the world within their own mental realm, their head. And then they're learning how to connect all of these things with language and help us, and even remember in some cases and imagine. The second example that I want to share with you is from the Facebook robots. And here my purpose was to build a robot that can interact with you not only once, but it can keep your interest. So you can speak again with him after one day, after 1 week, many times within a month or 3 months. And for that reason, it's trying to create shared memories with you, so it remembers the things that you did together, and shared friends, so it can spread gossip about the friends and have an interesting discussion. At the same time, it can meet with people physically or through Facebook, and also it can get information from Facebook that is relevant to them. Let us see that too.
Are you late to town camp?
Yes.
Late to town camp. Are you doing well today?
Yes.
Well, let me tell you some updated news from the world of technology. The games industry has condemned...
So here it's giving customized news.
That's great.
It has recognized the face of the person.
Yes, on Facebook it is working hard. I think that you know that a friend of those to me has posted a new photo in the foot of the moon.
No.
I am sending you an inbox message about
talking about common friends.
One of our common friends, Hannah's Julie, is in Bonn. Please send a message to our friend.
So it can connect people, one of which is online, the other physically there. Even get people to know one another.
I remember when we talked this morning that I had asked you about are you doing well today. And you were doing well and I talked a little about Chand in the tech. Anyway, it was nice speaking to you. Goodbye for now.
Pretty much. And then the third example after Sarah Facebook is Ebon Cena, which you very briefly saw in the beginning. And here the purpose was to create a shopping mall robot, or a museum robot, or even an interactive theater actor. And this robot actually spoke with thousands of people, as you shall see. A lot of degrees of freedom in the face. It can have facial expressions.
Assalamu alaikum.
Marhaba. A simple dialogue system in Arabic.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Khashman.
It even does the greeting of the Khaliji greeting. And it can take facial expressions corresponding to emotions. Sadness.
Disbelief. Mutahammas, excited.
And excitement. As you can imagine, this got a lot of publicity, so just a small sample follows. This is Agence France-Presse.
Un salut parfait.
ESMAC, Dubai TV, 30 countries around the world.
اسمي هو حسين ابن عبد الله.
Mensachtige robot die Arabisch spreekt.
And then the robot also went to shopping malls and to exhibitions and spoke with around 3,000 people. And it also flew on Emirates Airlines to Saudi Arabia, invited by the Minister of Education of Saudi. And here he is, very happy. And in the end, a letter that he wrote to Sheikh Mohammed bin Mubarak of the Emirates. So all of these three examples that I showed to you were examples of interaction between pairs, a human and a robot, speaking with one another. The next stage is group interaction, and in this case, we have a group of two robots and two humans from the NASA Robonaut project. And after that, what we reach is what one could call, in layman's terms, superorganisms that could have thousands of humans and machines connected tightly to one another and sharing their eyes and hands and brains, if you want. But what do I mean exactly by that? Let me give you an example. These are 10 red balloons. They're about, I think, 5 meters in diameter, and they were placed in random locations around the United States in 2009 as part of a DARPA research program. This was the network challenge, as they called it. And the goal of the teams that were taking part in the competition for these balloons, which were university teams, was to find a way to find them. And they could use whatever they want. They could use humans, they could use satellites, they could use machines. So the team that was actually able to win, which came from the MIT Media Lab, where I did my PhD too, used, what do you think? Social networks. So they used social networks in order to get to recruit thousands of people who pretty much spent 10 seconds of their time lending their eyes and their brain to the system to look around and check if they see a balloon. And then through the thousands of eyes that contributed to the system, we were able to find them in a very, very small time. Of course, you can extend this. You can get people give part of their brain abilities as services to the system. They can be translating text, they can be planning, they can be doing operations. And if you bring all of this together, then you get something that's much more similar, if you want, to this dance of the reincarnation of the Buddha that they have in China. So enough with interactive robots and the human-robot cloud. Now let me go to the third part of the talk and talk to you about the answer to the following question. How can we harness the collective mind of citizens in order to be able to bring forth effective participatory governance? Both in ancient Athens, as well as in Islam and many other cultures, one of the prime elements of politics is consultation, or shura, how it's usually called. The big issue, though, with shura is that you can easily do it at the level of a village. But how can you extend this to the multi-million people nations that we have today? This is a big problem, but this is exactly the opportunity in terms of technology for the first time in the history of humanity to try to do it. And a prime example of this, for example, is what His Excellency Sheikh Mohammed bin Mubarak, Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid had done in Dubai, in which through the UAE Brainstorm program, he brought about 10,000 of his citizens to contribute to the reformation of the education program of the Emirates by sending messages through Twitter and through the internet. And there are many cases in which electronic consultation in this case can really help bring forth new ideas and can really help people participate in what is happening. There are cases, though, where it's important to, if you want, get the physical element come in there. So that's why, as part of my involvement in Recreate Greece, which is a citizens' movement in Greece, I planned and organized a number of hybrid electronic and physical workshops for consultation, in which, again, we had many citizens of Greece coming together and brainstorming in order to plan for the renaissance of Greece after the crisis. And the important thing about the physical element in this case, which you cannot find so easily in the electronic, is the fact that you can have real friendships taking place in this meeting, and also the citizens that get involved later start group action together. So you actually get volunteer groups, too, that really do things and not just talk. And there are many other technologies that have become available right now to be able to enhance governance that are based on this collective mind of the people, if you want. There is liquid representation, there's participatory budgeting, there's online petitions, and much more that you can easily find if you see, for example, the World Forum of Democracy in Strasbourg. Also, there are many new technologies regarding being able to analyze public opinion. In a project that we started in my lab recently, we actually fetched 150,000 tweets that were related to the Obamacare website and how people reacted to it. And we were able to find out who the main influencers were, what the spheres of influence were, what the communication dynamics were, how the sentiment of the people was coming up and down over time, and how this whole thing was related to what was happening out there in terms of government announcements and the real project progress. And you were even able to actually get predictions from what is happening through this analysis of public opinion. Thus, in the smart cities of the future, and the green smart cities of the future, it's not just going to be the infrastructure that will be intelligent and the buildings and environmentally friendly. One of the most important elements, we think, in that respect, is to be able to harness both the skills and the mind and the opinions of all of the citizens in order to help governance and in order to, in the end, help them make their dreams come true. Thus, we have gone a long way. I started by talking about lifeless matter and went all the way to robots interacting with humans. Then we talked about individual intelligence and collective intelligence. And finally, we asked about the collective mind of the citizens and how it can help forth the new cities of the future. Let me thus just close with a vision of the future. Imagine a world in which humans, robots, and all the other intelligent and natural entities that will make up the complex biological and artificial ecosystem of tomorrow will coexist in peace, harmony, and mutual benefit, and in which, through our participation in larger entities, we will be able to reach a much more deep collective self-actualization. And finally, imagine a world in which, through the collective mind of the citizens, we will be able not only to have effective participatory governance, but most importantly, to help preserve and enjoy our most beautiful planet, its biosphere, and Mother Earth.